The Marshmallow Ghosts by Priscilla and Otto Friedrich. Pictures by Louis Slobodkin. It was 4 o'clock on the afternoon of October 31st, and what a bleak, gray afternoon it was. The wind whined and tugged at the fast cars rushing along the superhighway, and the cars shuddered and hissed as they sped down the turnoff to Doomsday Park, a little development on the outskirts of town. Soon, a baleful orange moon would rise over the brand new houses, and for the first time they would know what Halloween was like. They were going to be haunted. On the corner of Willow Wand Lane and Moonbeam Road stood a deserted ranch house. It had been the model house at Doomsday Park, and so many people had come to look at it that by now the poor house was quite shabby. The ranch houses next door and down the street were copies of this house, but they were neat and well cared for. They were happy and noisy with parents and children, dogs, cats, canaries, and TV sets, doll buggies, and tricycles. But no one at all wanted to live in the model house. No one but a family of ghosts. There were 4 ghosts haunting that deserted house. Lady Esther and her young niece and nephews, James, Joyce, and Sean. This particular afternoon found them all in the laundry room. Lady Esther was worried and excited.
"There you sit in your laundry baskets," she wailed at the little ghosts, "exhausted after one little spin in the dryer. What would you do if you had to wash in freezing water the way we had to back in Ireland? Why don't you get up and practice your gliding? Our first Halloween in America, and not one of you really knows how to glide gracefully." "But the dryer has made us so very nice and fluffy," said Joyce. "I look like silver moonlight shining through a mist. I look like a pale..."
"Never mind what you look like," interrupted Lady Esther. "It's the way that you act that is important. I don't know what's going to become of you if you can't learn to handle yourself like a proper ghost. All of you, you clomp around like truck drivers."
Lady Esther, more upset than ever, sat down and began a long lament for the country that they had left a few months ago.
"Oh, if we could only go back home to Ireland where we belong," she moaned, "back to Castle Shenanigan. Oh, that lovely, wicked fortress by the sea. Oh, why did we ever leave?"
"It wasn't our fault, Aunt Esther,"
said James, the oldest, and the only one who ever practiced at hovering and gliding.
"No, it was not," Lady Esther agreed sadly. "It was the tourists. All those silly people who heard about Castle Shenanigan being haunted and came to visit us."
Lady Esther moaned again, remembering how she had finally decided she could stand the tourists no longer. She had bundled up her niece and nephews into the first ship she caught sight of and brought them to America. But when the boat docked, Lady Esther had found the city too big and noisy and dirty, and not at all the right place to train a family of young ghosts. A kind witch had told her about the empty house and the housing development, and Lady Esther had taken the place immediately.
"Well, I'm glad we came. I like living here," Sean, the youngest, spoke up. "It's fun to watch the children go by our house on their roller skates and bicycles. I wish we could have roller skates."
James and Joyce said they wished so too, and they all began to talk at once about the wonderful toys they had seen the children playing with, and how much nicer it was to live here than at cold, wet, nasty old Castle Shenanigan.
"Silence! Hush, children!" hissed Lady Esther above the din. "Look, the moon has risen and the time has come. We're off!"
Lady Esther gave a deep sigh. As she did so, the door to the patio swung open of its own accord. The 3 young ghosts rose from their laundry baskets, excited and a little nervous. They followed Lady Esther as they had been taught, gliding silently in a straight line behind her, across the lawn and on to the broken cement sidewalk.
"We will go down to the supermarket first, my dears," whispered Lady Esther.
James, Joyce, and Sean nodded and then shivered with pleasure at the wonderful outing in store for them.
"Grown children," murmured Lady Esther as they entered through the supermarket's glass doors. "Groan!"
The 3 young ghosts groaned.
"Oh!"
The girl at the cash register felt her skin grow cold, and a woman dropped her bundle of jelly beans and cookies to the floor.
"Excellent! Well done!"
whispered Lady Esther to the children. "Now, I want you to separate and glide up and down the aisles. Do your best to frighten everyone."
And she trailed off to scare the high school boys stacking cartons in the basement. But just as Lady Esther had floated out of sight, the 3 little ghosts noticed that they were standing right in front of the candy counter.
"Look at those marshmallows," said Sean.
He picked up a bag and began eating.
"Stop that,"
James said sternly. "Glide over to the frozen foods and start frightening people." But Joyce had started to gobble down marshmallows, too, and in the end, James stayed and ate just as many as his sister and brother did. When the little ghosts had finished the last marshmallow, something very strange had happened to them. They were just as visible as anyone else, and they could no longer fade in or out, or disappear and then take shape again the way a good ghost should. They couldn't float. They couldn't glide. They couldn't hover.
"Okay, kids, that's enough,"
a rather gruff voice said behind them. It was the store manager.
"Some fancy costumes you got there, but don't be standing in front of the candy counter all night. The store's closing now. Where's your mother?"
At that moment, the store manager began to shiver as he felt an icy hand grasp his. When he looked, he was holding several Irish sixpences which Lady Esther had given him to pay for the marshmallows. The three little ghosts hurried to the door, followed by their aunt.
"Oh, you foolish little ghosts!"
Lady Esther wailed as they stood together in the parking lot outside the supermarket.
"Just look at yourselves! You can't even disappear! Go home right now before anyone catches sight of such greedy, disgraceful ghosts! Stay there and wait for me!"
Lady Esther shuddered and gave a disgusted groan and disappeared in the direction of a gasoline station.
"Go home! Go home!"
they heard her wail across the empty streets. The three little ghosts started back to their house, looking just like other children bundled up in old sheets. Joyce was very sorry for what they had done, and she began to cry.
"Listen," James exclaimed excitedly as they tramped down the street, "if we can't act like ghosts anymore, we can pretend to be real children and play trick-or-treat, and we can go to all the Halloween parties." "Aunt Esther won't like that. She told us to go home right away," Joyce said. "Oh, come on, Joyce. We'll get home before Aunt Esther does, but let's have some fun first. Maybe the children will let us ride their bicycles and cars."
When Joyce thought of the dolls she had seen the little girls playing with, she quickly agreed with her brother, and Sean thought it was a wonderful idea, so off they went. Up and down the lanes and roads and courts and drives of Doomsday Park, the three young ghosts laughed and chattered. They went from house to house, collecting candy and putting it into the large brown paper bags which a kind woman had given them at their first stop. The children they met on their way thought they were the best and spookiest trick-or-treaters they had ever seen. A little boy dressed as a clown came up to Sean and tried to change costumes with him.
"Say, how would you like to be a clown?" he asked. "Oh, very much," Sean said shyly. "A cowboy is best, but next to that I'd like to be a clown." "Well, let's change costumes then," replied his new friend. "This clown suit is too small for me. My brother wore it last year, and now I have to wear it, even though I'm almost as big as he is. Why don't we change costumes right now?"
"But I can't," said Sean.
"Why not?" the little boy asked. "Say, where did your mother buy that costume anyway? What is it, some new plastic?"
"It's not plastic. It's me. I'm a ghost."
"Huh?"
answered the boy. He felt Sean's arm. His hand passed right through it. It looked like an arm, but it just wasn't there.
"Hey!" the boy shouted. "You are a ghost!"
And he ran off. The three little ghosts left that street as fast as they could. But when they reached another block, they started in trick-or-treating again. Whenever they came to a house where a party was going on, they walked right through the door and down to the playroom where the noise was coming from. James won prizes everywhere at bobbing for apples, and he and Sean looked at cars and bicycles stored in adjoining garages. Joyce played with all the dolls and ironing boards and bassinets she saw, and she won prizes at Pin the Tail on the Donkey. By now, all three ghosts wore black masks and paper hats, which they had won or been given. They carried little cardboard jack-o'-lanterns as well as their bags full of candies and cookies. Sean had a beautiful black and orange balloon which he had received when it was quite clear that he wasn't ever going to win any game at all. At last it was time to go home.
"Your parents are going to be looking for you. I'm afraid they'll be worried," said the mother at the last house.
She was helping her own little girl out of a pretty ballerina costume. The party was over. Her little boy was picking up the crepe paper, broken horns, and paper bags from the floor.
"Better go home now," she called out again to the little ghost. "It's getting late. Do you want me to call your mother? Perhaps she can drive over and pick you up."
"Oh, no,"
said James, looking up from a set of trains.
"We don't live far. Come on, Joyce and Sean, it's time to go."
And then all three ghosts said, "Thank you very much," and "We had a lovely time," and they left the house with their politest groan. Mrs. Jones shuddered and closed the door quickly behind them.
"Who were those children?" she asked. "Are any of them from your class, Tommy?" "No," Tommy answered. "But I like 'em, Mother."
The three worried little ghosts hurried down the street to their house. Would Lady Esther be there waiting for them? Would she scold them for being late? They were covered with chocolate and cookie crumbs, and although James threw away his mask, they couldn't bear to part with her jack-o'-lanterns or balloons or paper bags filled with candy and pennies and apples. Lady Esther was waiting for them in the kitchen, perched on her favorite spot on top of the refrigerator. But before she could say a word, there was a loud banging on the front door. The next moment, it swung open, and two policemen came into the living room.
"Hide yourselves!" hissed Aunt Esther as she faded away.
The three little ghosts hid themselves in the kitchen cupboards. The policemen searched the dark corners of the living room with their powerful flashlights.
"No sign of them, Joe," one said. "Nothing here at all. Nobody in this house."
Better check the kitchen and the basement, Mac. Those people across the street swear they saw three kids come in here a few minutes ago, so we'd better make sure."
"Well, there's no sign of breaking and entering," replied Mac as they went toward the kitchen.
He wasn't very happy poking around the dark house. And then Lady Esther reappeared to protect the three little ghosts, for it would be many hours before the marshmallows wore off, and they were still visible as ordinary children. How pleased they were as they peeped from behind the cupboard doors and watched their aunt float slowly toward the living room. She glimmered and glowered, moaned and sighed. Her arms were outstretched, and her long robes trailed behind her in an eerie light. She was wonderful. She had never been more ghostly.
"A spirit!"
shouted the policeman, and fled from the house. The little ghost rushed out from the cupboards.
"Oh, Aunt Esther," said Joyce, "I wish I could learn to glide like that. I'm going to practice and practice."
"Hush now, children. I must think. The damage has been done."
"That's the trouble. The policemen have gone, but other policemen will be sent to investigate when they hear that this house is haunted. We must leave at once."
Catching sight of Sean's worried little face, she said, "Now, it's not that bad. I have an excellent plan. In a house that was haunted tonight, I overheard a fascinating conversation. It concerned a section of this country called New England, and it appears that New England has a great many haunted houses. We will go and live there." And so, that very night, Aunt Esther and the little ghosts left the ranch house. After a few miles of trudging along the roads, James, Joyce, and Sean were almost invisible again. When they really were quite invisible and could float properly, Lady Esther glided ahead of them into a truck, and they all followed. After a long ride, the truck stopped at a hotel in the Berkshire Mountains in New England. It was very quiet and empty during the winter months, just the place for the ghost family, and they settled down happily. In time, they heard of other ghosts in the neighborhood, and now they have many friends. Lady Esther is especially happy because none of the other ghosts has ever lived in Ireland, and she loves telling them of her distinguished ancestors and the grandeur of the Castle Shenanigan. But on Halloween, every time that night comes around, James, Joyce, and Sean have a holiday. They solemnly stuff themselves with marshmallows, and as soon as they really look like children in sheets, they skip away from the hotel to have a wonderful time trick-or-treating and going to Halloween parties.